Welcome back to Sunday Morning Quickies, episode 52 for the 7th of August, 2022. Well, I'm back from my little two-week hiatus. I'm not going to call it a vacation because it certainly was not a vacation. But 2 weeks off of working in the shop and doing videos. And honestly, it's just been too hot and humid to really do anything. So it's still kind of bad now. It's not as bad as it was for the past couple of weeks. But it's good enough that we can get through and do a Sunday Morning Quickies. This week, we're going to go back to our roots a little bit. One of the first machines I featured on any YouTube video was a Singer 127. Well, today, I'm going to go back to the Vibrating Shuttles. I've got on the bench a Model 28, a very old Model 28. I've had a lot of emails and private messages and comments on Facebook posts lately. People having problems making the adjustments with their Singer Vibrating Shuttle machines. And, yeah, it can be a little tough to do if you're not familiar with the procedure. And it is a little different than working on a 66 or a 15 class machine. So I figured what we're going to do, I have on my website, and there'll be a link down below, a really nice cleaned up copy of the 127 adjuster's manual. Now, the difference between, it's actually the 127 and 128 adjuster's manual. The differences between a 27 and a 127 and a 28 and a 128 are so minor for the purposes of what we're going to be talking about. So I'm going to use this 28 and we're going to go through and talk about some of the important adjustments to make as far as stitch formation goes on the Singer Vibrating Shuttle machine. So go ahead, make yourself a cup of coffee or a frozen margarita, maybe even more appropriate in this weather, but depends upon what time of the day you're looking at this. Kick back and we'll get right back in on this. I've taken the shuttle cover slides off of this machine. I haven't taken the needle plate off yet. Now, I've got to apologize for how funky this machine looks. I can't say this machine is completely in as found condition because it's not. I've done some work underneath. I haven't done anything in the needle bar box. I really haven't done anything cosmetic to this machine. When I bought this machine a couple of years ago, it was actually missing a part. And when I was able to source the part and I went to go put it in, I did a little cleanup down below. If you're curious what the problem was, the eccentric bolt that attaches down here, let me zoom in on that. The eccentric bolt that attaches this linkage to the pitman arm on the vertical shaft was missing when I bought this machine, and it was funny, somebody had put a cotter pin in there. So while yes, the mechanism moved, it was not exactly in stitch forming abilities. So I was able to source an eccentric bolt and a nut and everything, and this little old machine, she works really, really well. But while I was doing that, I did take some of this apart and cleaned it up a little bit. I just haven't gotten around to the rest of the machine yet. This machine actually, it has a hand crank on it. It originally had an original Singer hand crank. That original Singer hand crank is now on a 15-30 that's over in Kenya, a machine that Liz and I donated to a friend's nonprofit that helps the Maasai people. So it's got a Chinesium hand crank on it now that it works okay. It's not as nice as a Singer, but it works all right. And what this machine's great, this particular machine's great claim to fame is, I use it with a singer buttonholer, and do hand crank buttonholes on this machine. But anyway, so like I said, this machine is pretty much in as found condition. So, as I mentioned many times in the past, I've got a really nice copy of the Singer 127, 128 Adjusters Manual up on my website, link down below. It's free. You can download it, print it, do whatever you want. But we're going to go through a couple of pages on it. And there are some things that I want to talk about that I just can't get a camera in there and show you. It's just not going to happen. This particular camcorder that I'm using does not focus close enough. Anyway, we're going to start at page 8 on the manual, the adjuster's manual. I printed out pages 8 through 14. And you'll find that those are the most important ones. Actually, I don't know if page 14 will really get used. Yeah, it will. But pages, we're going to start on page 8. The bottom of page 8, there's an illustration, and to the right of that it says, position of shuttle point in relation to needle. A couple things you have to understand about these vibrating shuttle machines. If you've been working on like 66s and 99s or 15s and stuff like that, those machines, the point of their hook, their shuttles, they're running in a fixed, position. Like a 66 is running on an axle, you know, it's got an axle built into it. It's always going to be traveling in the same plane. Likewise, a 15 is, it's pretty much a captured shuttle in a 15. Featherweights and 301s, same thing. Now, there are some adjustments you can make on, say, 15 class and other vertically running bobbins, vertically running shuttles, where you might be moving the hook assembly closer or farther away from the needle. But really, on most of those machines, those are adjustments that we're never going to make. The vibrating shuttle machines, they're a horse of a different color. And I've talked about vibrating shuttles before, but we're going to get into a little bit in the weeds on this. We'll start first with position of the shuttle point in relation to the needle. Now, I'm going to, I'll just put up an illustration showing from the manual, because I'll never be able to show it well enough directly on camera. I am going to take the needle plate off for a moment. You're going to be looking with the shuttle in up alongside the needle, and you're going to be looking down in this area here where I'm pointing. The illustration from the manual is far better than what I could possibly do with a camera here. Let me read what it says here. It says, the needle should be as close as possible to the shuttle point without interfering with the shuttle point as shown in figure 13. The setting is necessary in order to prevent breaking of threads and or skipping of stitches. If the needle is too far away from the shuttle, the needle or the needle bar may be bent or the shuttle may be worn. After replacement of damaged parts, further adjustment may be made on the height of the needle bar as described on page 9. The manual, on page 9, starts out here to set the needle bar to the correct height. Let me just read you what it says first. It says, to check the height of the needle bar, remove the needle and turn the balance wheel over until the needle bar is at its lowest position. Well, there, that would be its lowest position right there. That's its lowest spot. When the needle bar is in this position, the distance from the bottom of the needle stop screw, C, figure 14, to the top of the throat plate should be approximately 13/16 of an inch as shown in figure 14. Now, what that means is not what a lot of people think
it means. When you insert your needle, it stops up against a little thing inside the needle bar. What it's stopping up against is this screw here. Now, in order to make that measurement, you're going to have to pull this screw and take off, well, maybe not take it off. You might be able to do it with just, you're going to have to take the needle clamp off. So we're going to try to get that. I've got that screw slightly loosened. You know what? It's not going to come off without, it's not going to get past, oh, maybe. Maybe we can. Nope, it's not going to get past that thread guide without taking the screw out first. So, I've already loosened the screw. And believe me, playing with this in this heat and humidity has not been fun. So I'm going to take the screw out the rest of the way. I'll grab it. I'm going to take the thread guide off at the same time. Take off the rest of the needle clamp. Now, separating the thread guide from the screw, I'm going to put the screw back into the hole. I'm just not going to screw it in all the way. Now, how are you going to get in there and measure? You're not. You're going to need to make a gauge. Right? This is not cool. So what I did was I went out to the garage, and I like to keep ultra-high molecular weight plastic, chunks of it, in the garage. So I cut a piece on the bandsaw just slightly over, I used 26-30 seconds as my measurement, but I cut it slightly, very slightly over, so that I could put this in a vise and then use a block plane and trim this down and get it to exactly 13/16 of an inch. So what you want is we get that gauge in that, this gauge block I just made. So it's at its lowest point. It's hitting the screw. Now, if we had to adjust it up or down, let me move the machine. Actually, let me gather some pieces here and get that out of the way. Now, with the gauge block in the back, if we needed to make adjustments, we could take a screwdriver, loosen this screw, which is, this screw only gives about a 32nd of an inch total movement ability, and then loosen the clamping screw. And here you can see, get this sufficiently loosened so we can move the needle bar. I'm going to hold the needle bar. There's very little motion there. So with that all the way down, which it is all the way down, we get that. We're making contact. That's close enough. And once again, like everything else Singer says, you got to read it carefully. This, just like when they're talking about timing in a 66 or a 99 or whatever, it does say approximately, you know, when they're talking about needle bar height. So, okay, so we got our gauge made. It works out. When it's full down, boom, 13/16 of an inch. It's a god-awful way of making that measurement. I don't agree with the way they did it. I think it would have been so much better had they come up with some sort of a measurement to say just even to the bottom of the needle bar. But it's what they came up with. So anyway, that is a big sticking point for a lot of people because they don't necessarily adjust these correctly according to Singer. Now, I didn't used to do it that way either. Honestly, I made this relatively recently. But I was adjusting my needle bar height in using a different adjustment that they show a little bit later on, which we're going to get to next. Oh, no, actually, we're not going to get to it next. We're going to have to put the needle bar clamp and the thread guide and everything back together, because the next step up is the correct the location of the needle in relation to the throat plate. So let me get that back together and I'll bring you back and I'll show you how you do that. The next item up for business on the on page 9 of the adjuster's manual, they talk about to correct the location of the needle in relation to the throat plate. Now, this is something, this is one of the few machines you're going to run into where the throat plate is adjustable. But, the illustration shown, that illustration here, I'll pop it up on screen, is very important because this is the same on just about every machine ever made. You do not want your needle centered in the hole in the throat plate or needle plate, call it what you wish. You can see in the illustration, they show that there's a 9 through a 19, and this side of the needle is always in this back side of the needle here. As you're looking at it, it'll be on the right hand side on this particular machine. That's always in the same location. The needles get fatter on the opposite side. So what they're saying is when the needle enters the hole in the throat plate, the short groove side of the needle should come close to the right side of the needle hole, as shown in figure 13 and 15. This location of the needle leaves sufficient clearance for the needle thread as the size of the needle increases towards the left. At no time should the needle either touch the edge of the needle hole or locate in the center of the needle hole. And then if you flip over to page 10, it continues. It says, when the needle is located incorrectly in the needle hole of the throat plate, check for the following causes. Bent needle, worn or damaged needle bar, they're saying replace. Dirt, clogged needle seat in needle bar, clean it. Incorrectly seated throat plate, adjust. Now, there is a level of adjustment with this single screw. You can, if you loosen this, you can actually move this around just a slight amount, that's all you really need. And they're saying here, of course, the throat plate may be adjusted after loosening throat plate screw E, which is this one right here, in figure 14. So, now they mention something here. This is not the first time they mentioned it. Worn or damaged needle bar, and then parens, replace. These machines are very, very old. You're not going to find brand new parts. You might find used parts on eBay. You're not going to find new parts. So, just keep that in mind. You know, these machines are pretty durable. Honestly, I think this particular one here was made like 1912. And it still works great. It's not pretty by any stretch of the imagination. Her decals are shot. Her paint is horrible. But she still sews really, really well. So, something to consider. I mean, you know, these machines are not getting any newer. They're not exactly making new parts for these. Just keep that in mind. Anyway, moving right along, to set the presser bar at the correct height, this is much like doing any other machine. When the presser foot is raised, there should be a clearance of 5/16 of an inch between the presser foot and the throat plate. I do not have a presser foot on this machine at the moment, but we've seen this a million times before. I've done this a ton of times. I'm a huge advocate of using this little thing from the Featherweight shop. This thing works great. It's not rocket science. And I have other videos where I show that. If you've watched any of my videos on the Featherweight or on the 99 or the 66, you'll see where I go through that. But anyway, it says when the presser foot is raised, there should be a clearance of 5/16 of an inch between the presser foot and the throat plate. At this setting, and with the needle bar set at the correct height, neither the needle bar nor the needle clamp can strike the presser foot. And that is true. If it's too low, if the needle bar is too low, this is going to whack up against the thread guide on the needle plate, that's for certain, on the needle bar, and this can come crashing down and hit that presser foot. It says to set the presser foot at the correct height, raise the presser bar lifter to its highest position, loosen set screw F, figure 14, that would be this one right here, and raise or lower the presser bar as required. Then, after locating the presser foot in relation to the needle as described below, retighten the set screw F, which is this one right here. Now, what they're talking about is as far as reorienting the presser foot, and I'll put the graphic up so it's a little bit easier to see. You can see how the hole for the in the needle plate, how you want that oriented towards the two toes, the long and the short toe of the presser foot. And that's just simply a matter of loosening that set screw and rotating. Moving along to page 11 of the adjuster's manual, the top of page 11, to check the shuttle for correct height. Normally, like on a 66 or a 99, when we're adjusting needle bar height, we're moving the needle bar up and down and getting it in relationship to the point of the hook. Well, in this case, we have the shuttle here, and what we're going to do is we're going to put the shuttle in the position where it's properly timed, meaning that the point of the shuttle is equal to where the it's in the middle of the needle. And at that point, what we'll be doing is we'll be adjusting so that the point of the shuttle is approximately a 16th of an inch above the top of the opening of the eye of the needle. I'll put the illustration up, but let me read you what it says in the manual. It says, before checking the shuttle, check the needle bar for correct height as described on page 9. All right, we did that. That's why we made this little gauge, this gauge block thingy. All right. Then put the needle up on the needle bar as far as it will go and turn the balance wheel over towards you until the shuttle point reaches the center of the needle. Well, that's what I've got right here, right now. In this position, the shuttle point should be 1/16th of an inch above the top of the needle eye as shown in figure 17. If the shuttle is set too high, it may strike the bed slide. And if the shuttle is set either too high or too low in relation to the needle eye, it may interfere with the proper formation of the stitch. When the shuttle is not at the correct height, check for wear and need of replacement of the bell crank hinge screw, bell crank N, figure 23, shuttle carrier arm R, figure 23. After new parts are installed, it still may be necessary to bend the shuttle carrier arm R close to the shuttle carrier bell crank N. This should be done very carefully. Now, let me move this around a little bit. This is the shuttle carrier here. This is what they're talking about bending. That has to be done very, very carefully. Extremely carefully. Now, there is one screw that holds the shuttle carrier onto the bell crank arm. The next adjustment that they talk about in the manual, and I would, honestly, I would do this, you're going to have to, if you have to wind up bending things, you're going to have to go back and forth between the bending adjustment and the next adjustment until you, it's going to be a dance and a balance to get it right. And that is to adjust the thread clearance of the shuttle. It says use narrow feeler gauge serial 187928. I think they mean part number 187928. The thickness of there's two thicknesses on that feeler gauge. There's 15 thousandths and 18 thousandths. It says to check the thread gauge of the shuttle, pull the front bed slide out and turn the balance wheel over towards you until shuttle G is at the end of its stroke away from the operator, which would be back there, all the way back. Then using the feeler gauge H, figure 18, with leaves 15 thousandths and 18 thousandths of an inch, check the clearance of the shuttle at the four points shown in figures 18, 19, 20, and 21. You're not going to find that Singer part number. There are feeler gauges. Regular automotive-style feeler gauges are going to be too large to get in there and do this. There are tapered feeler gauges available. You can get them on Amazon. I've got a set. They work fine. What you can also use, if you have a set of these wire feeler gauges that Mark Sumpter sells, these are from sish.com. Mark occasionally sells these. He doesn't always have them available. These have a 14 and an 18 thousandths wire. These will work. What I did before I had any of those resources, I took some automotive style feeler gauges and I cut them down. And I made, granted these are kind of sloppy, but I made a 12, a 15, and an 18. But I made them specifically, so I rounded them down, I narrowed them up and I rounded them down specifically so I could get into those tight spaces. After I cut them, I then very carefully deburred the edges. Are they exactly still at 15, 12, and 18 thousandths? They're pretty damn close. They work well as go, no-go gauges, if nothing else. Anyway, if you had made the previous adjustment, which involved bending the carrier, you're definitely going to have to make some adjustments towards the positioning, the thread clearance. So anyway, let's continue on what it says about it. On top of page 12, it says, note, feeler gauge leaf 15 thousandths of an inch thick should slip freely, while feeler gauge leaf 18 thousandths of an inch should fit snugly at each position indicated. To adjust the thread clearance between the shuttle and the shuttle raceway, loosen screw L, figure 23, and screw L, in this case, is the screw that's underneath that. Let me move this back here a little bit. It's the screw underneath that holds the shuttle carrier to the bell crank. We can't see it. It's actually underneath here, but it's the screw that secures the shuttle carrier to the bell crank. To adjust the thread clearance between the shuttle heel and the shuttle carrier spring J, that's the back end of this thing, check for wear and adjust and need for replacement of bell crank N, figure 23, and hinge screw. Like I said, you're not going to find new parts for these machines. So any of these adjustments you're going to be making, it's going to be a bit of a dance. You're going to have to go back and forth between them. Just go very, very slow and very careful. Don't go cranking on stuff when you're bending it. Please, 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 either buy some smooth jawed pliers or buy a pair of needle nose pliers and spend some quality time with your pliers and a file and file all the teeth off so you're not marring the surfaces here when you're grasping and bending. And having more than one smooth jawed pair of pliers is a big, big plus. Another thing you might want to consider, pliers like these that have nylon jaws, these are available in different sizes. I have a couple of different sizes of these. I would recommend getting a couple of pairs of these in various sizes. In this case, you would need smaller sizes, just so you don't go marring stuff up. To time the shuttle, we're still on page 12, by the way. On machines which do not have timing marks on the shuttle raceway, okay, there's two different sets of instructions on how to do this. So if this for machines which do not have timing marks on the shuttle raceway, before timing the shuttle, check the needle bar for excessive up-down play due to wear of needle bar cam and roller. Honestly, I've never seen one of these things where the parts were worn out like that. So it's replaced when necessary. Then set the needle bar and shuttle to correct height as described on pages 9 and 11. Yeah, we've already done that. To check the timing of the shuttle, turn the balance wheel over towards you until the needle, after reaching its lowest point, there it says lowest point, rises approximately 3/32 of an inch. At this time, the point of the shuttle should be at the center of the needle blade, as shown in figure 22. All right, well, 3/32 of an inch, that's pretty much standard if you have any of the standard timing gauges. Once again, that's another opportunity to spend a little bit of money and buy one of Mark's timing gauge sets,
Or you can get the fancy one that I've got that costs like $80, which is definitely not worth it for doing something like this. Or, conversely, if you look at, I know I did a video a while back where I showed how you can use a magnet, get this at its lowest point. Now, I showed it on a 66. It would be so much easier on this. Just find a reference point. I would use something on the needle bar, the needle clamp or something. Magnet a proper small scale ruler to the front of the machine, and then you could just manually move the needle bar up. If you have a hand crank on your machine like this one does, by all means, take the hand crank off. The hand crank wants to keep this thing moving. And if you just move it ever so slightly, the extra weight on the mechanism, the weight of the gearing on the mechanism will keep it moving. So get it off if you're going to actually have to do that. All right, so we've got, where were we here? We've raised the point rises approximately 3/32 of an inch. At this time, the point of the shuttle should be at the center of the needle as shown in figure 22. To time the shuttle properly, loosen nut S, figure 24, using wrench, just the part number is 161323, and turn the eccentric stud T, figure 24, over to the right until the point of the shuttle reaches the center of the needle blade. Then, while firmly holding stud T in position, re-tighten nut S. All right, the parts we're talking about are down here at the pitman arm, where the arm that drives the bell crank, I should say the arm that drives the bell crank comes off the pitman arm. This is the eccentric. You need to get in here with the appropriate size wrench to loosen that up. You're not going to find Singer part number or tool number 161323, but what you can find is a set of ignition wrenches, and I'll have a link down below where you can get ignition wrenches. There'll be one in the set that would fit that. But anyway, that's where the adjustment is for the timing. It couldn't be any farther away than up here, but once again, this is an eccentric, so as you move it, it's going to slightly, even though nothing else is going to move, it'll slightly alter the position of this rod, which will in turn move the bell crank, which will in turn move the shuttle. So, it's actually pretty simple. Okay, if you've survived through that last explanation, if you're dealing with a machine that does have timing marks would be down in here, where I'm pointing with the screwdriver. The procedure is exactly the same. It's just a matter of where you're placing things. But you're still going to be making that adjustment down here. So I won't bore you with all of the details on that. That pretty much sums up what the adjustments are that you have to deal with these. It's not super difficult, but it's very different than what we're used to. If you're used to doing 66 class machines or 99s, or if you're used to doing a 15, it's a very different procedure for making these adjustments. And it's one of the reasons why I made sure that I cleaned up. I found the best copy of the adjuster's manual that I could find online. And then I spent a lot of time with that document. It was a PDF. I opened up the PDF in Adobe Photoshop, each individual page, and I cleaned each page up, and I spent an inordinate amount of time on the illustrations because what was out there was actually pretty ugly. And then I reassembled the whole thing. I've put that document up on my website. It's also up on a couple of the Facebook groups in their files section. The Vintage Singer Sewing Machine group, I believe I put it there. It's also on the Sewing Machine Resource group. So by all means, it's on my website. The link is down below. Go get that manual. you know, you're free to use it, do whatever you want. I mean, there's no charge for it. It's on my website. Now, I don't own the copyright on it anyway. All I did was clean the bloody thing up and make it available to you. So it's pretty much a public domain thing at this point. Anyway, that's all I got for you this week. I wanted to go through this because, like I said, I've had a lot of correspondence about these machines this week. It is still extremely hot and humid here in the great state of New Jersey, and I'm hoping things settle down relatively quickly. Anyway, so that's my little 28. That's how you make the adjustments on them. So thank you guys so much for watching, and we'll see you on the next one. One last thing. If you happen to be in New Jersey, October 29th, 2022, you can come on down to Leonardo to New Jersey Blind Citizens Association. Liz and I will be there. We're going to be helping out. They're having a big craft fair and makers fair and everything. Should be a lot of fun. There's going to be some musicians. There's going to be stuff for the kids to do and stuff for the adults as well. So anyway, if you happen to be in the area, I'll put a little doobly-doo up on that. And we'd love to see you.